mad in the last 2 minutes, but you know what?
We were talking about the crisis in education, and we just want to follow up a little bit more about this and continue where we left off, because there are some very real questions here. What's the solution to the student debt crisis?
Sure.
That's one that we started talking about a little bit. Let's follow up a little bit more without the time slot constraint here. What are some other ways that our nation could handle the student debt crisis? Is it realistic to say, as some political figures say, oh, we ought to just write it off? I mean, what happens? How does that get paid for? Is that realistic?
No, it's not realistic. I mean, someone's going to pay for it. That becomes socialism in its purest form. Yeah. Just putting it off, you can't.
It doesn't go away.
It doesn't go away. There's still a cost, but it would be nice to see, and I've seen some, you know, people suggesting whatever, there needs to be some market reforms in this whole process. There really, really does. There's got to be. And I think the community colleges, you'll notice, are getting, especially here in the Charlotte area, I know we can speak for that. That's where we live. We are having more experience with it. That they are beginning to step up to the plate.
Yeah.
Because parents, and by the way, you know, not every teen wants to run off and go live in a dorm.
Right.
We understand that. They're trying to be trained in whatever area they're trying to do. And community colleges are beginning to step up to the plate.
Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, in all fairness to young people too,
which I think is going to pressure colleges to maybe, that's my whole point in coming back around to that.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
To begin taking a look at what they're doing.
I think if parents who've raised their children in a way that they've had a good relationship, and the children are respectful and are willing to listen to the parents, I think the parents can be the mature person in the room who can be able to influence their teen and say, look, I know it may sound appealing to go with your friends off to such and such a college, but look, do you realize what it's going to do? Because we're not going to take out a second mortgage on our home, and some parents do. But this is a wise decision. I think what it does is it actually trains young people to make wise decisions, for parents to be strong. Mm-hmm. Say, don't be just influenced by peer pressure. Don't be influenced by covetousness. But look, we've got some good solutions that are reasonable, like buying a vehicle. Mm-hmm. You know, as opposed to saying buy a Corvette, it's okay. Instead, buy the inexpensive one.
Yeah, and you know, there is also a stigma about adult children living at home.
Mm-hmm.
And I think obviously there is a point where it becomes an issue. It's time for Junior to move on. But we have kind of created an artificial line, 18, we say that children are adults, and I suppose legally they're adults, but they're not yet in a position to really take on, you know, 17 years and 11 months and 29 days, they don't suddenly become a different person 2 days later. So I think even taking the stigma away of young people, it's an economically smart decision to stay home and commute to a college for a few years, and even to start to develop a adult relationship with their parents.
Yeah, sure.
One thing I really appreciated about as time went on, establishing and getting to know our dad as an adult, and it's different than when you're a teen.
Yeah.
And so for some of the families that I've known that when they stayed home and they went to college and they were there for 2 or 3 or 4 years, and they value and cherish those years, mm-hmm. but there was a stigma.
Yep.
There were some who said, "Well, you got to let go of the apron strings."
Yeah.
But by the way, there's an impetus though on the parents too, I think, to actively be helping their children to work their way into society.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And what I'm meaning by this is that, you know, in colonial days, you know, you think about it, they were master this, master that. If you wanted to be a trade, you became a master. It took a long time to become a trade. So where did you live in the meantime? Well, you probably lived at home. and you're helping out with a family, you know, whatever's going on with a family household to get there.
Right.
And sometimes I think parents, we can get caught in the trap where they turn 18 and we want them to make all their own decisions.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Right.
I guess legally they can say, "I'm not listening to you anymore. I'm leaving." But you know, we're hoping that we're starting when they're young to training our children, and for us to be active too.
Yeah. Right.
To noticing what they're good at, what they have a proclivity to, and help push them, help lead them to those paths.
Right.
Because
we
want them to be, if you're going to be in a trade,
absolutely.
Not to be the guys just sweeping the floor. Yeah. We want you to be a master at it.
Yeah. Right.
Because then you can provide for your family.
And
again, those kind of things.
And there's a time when you can coach. That's a time when you can coach them into becoming an adult, into becoming responsible, and without them having to have the burden of all their expenses that cost. Because you know, living completely on your own, the costs in food, shelter, fuel, vehicle, insurance, all these things is immense.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And by being able to give them the coaching, the support, the help, as opposed to feeling like they're a failure because they don't, you know, they're not on their own, I think is a beneficial thing. Even some of the emotional challenges that face young girls at that time who are trying to deal with a now potential mate, and all the different, to be able to be there emotionally, to encourage, I think it's taking a proper responsibility. If parents will be mindful of encouraging them in their new life, and I think that's the caveat.
And I I just want to add that what we're saying is not sort of let's hold on to them as long as we can
to protect them from
the world. And I think that can be taken wrong.
Yeah.
It's not that way at all. It's that as they have a launching pad, but and then we as parents, we give them more and more room to maneuver as they age. And so they're capable, like you said, they're ready when they're for a trade or whatever they've got. They're ready and prepared, and they're not pushed out before they're ready. When, hey, in this world, kids are pushed into stuff so early when they're not prepared, and so we're not protecting them from ever interacting with the world. We're actually preparing them for doing it in a way that is proper and is safe.
And someone might think in the audience, well, we're going away from the question at hand, but I don't think so. Because we talk about student debt, we're talking about responsible, mature decision making, really, aren't we?
Right.
And it's not just accumulation of financial obligation. It goes with a lot of issues. So I understand we're bringing this into a very personal, family-oriented discussion, as opposed to trying to solve it in some sort of a national way, which I would say is part of the problem. Because trying to solve something in a national way is what gets into all kinds of problems, frankly. Mm-hmm. Whether you look at welfare or whatever it may be, it's a personal decision making, family by family, that really makes a change.
I want to add another segment to this. That I think what they're talking about, a lot of these articles that we're referring to, is we're talking about two people who both went to college, who both have staggering debts, who then both get married, and then they have children, and now they're faced with what do we do with the children, and what do we do with the staggering debt? I think part of the picture has to be, and for young women, is what do I really want from my life when they're 17, 18, 19? Do I want to have children? Do I want to raise children? And if so, where am I going to be, you know, when in those years when that those are the child bearing years and training and raising years, and am I going to be so invested in a college debt in a college career, financially and emotionally, that I'm going to be trapped.
Yeah.
And I think that is also part of the big picture of analyzing that. Where do I want to be? Instead of just following the crowd and getting the high-powered career, regardless, of where I want to be in 15, 20 years.
And it's an appreciation of we get back to appreciation of the family, isn't it? Because when we begin to appreciate the family and all that revolves around the family, what happens is then even decisions into what you study and how you study and leaving options, making right. sure you have the options that if you're on more difficult times, you can be able to earn, but you're not bound to this massive debt. That's a better way.
Right.
But it's breaking the cycle though, isn't it? It's breaking the cycle because it's so easy to fall into the cycle where your choices right. are very limited.
And, yes.
Right.
You know,
right.
So
it's like our great experiment, our societal experiment that we've had has been to push everything away, and it's really coming back now to the family.
Mm-hmm.
If a strong family unit, and you can say, well, I'm not in that situation, but you can prepare your children, if you have mm-hmm. children, that that cycle is broken.
Yeah,
bring
right.
it back to the strong right. family unit.
Right.
And then a lot of these things fall into place.
Right. But I think a lot of parents miss it, though. They don't realize they're setting the stage for their children to replicate mm-hmm. the challenges that they're facing.
Certainly.
You know.
And by the way, we're talking about the, you know, what drives the economic engine of somewhat, you could say, thou shalt not covet in a way. That affects the parents, too. Because yeah. they get 18,
right.
I want
right.
you out of my house because I can't pay for you anymore.
Yeah.
You
right.
need to get out there on your own. You know, you need to go to college. Well, you go live at college, and
that's right.
instead of
then
that's part of it too. That's part
my
of it
food
too.
Bill.
That's my food bill.
That's right.
Yeah. Type of a thing. So
yeah.
Well, I appreciate you guys taking a little more time and chewing on this a little bit more, and hopefully when we air this will be a little bit. A little bit further discussion that our audience can see a little bit of maybe more relaxed, less time-driven discussion of the challenge. Because look, we're parents too. We're wrestling with the same challenge. It's real. It's part of our national cultural challenge that we're facing today. But we would our desire is to actually look towards a biblical perspective that we keep referring to as we go along, and to see what are the principles that really can be able to guide us into good decision making, even including something that is very pertinent, very current, which is this crisis in education, finances, morals that we're facing today. Well, thanks for being with us for a little bit longer today, and hope you enjoy this. You take care, and we'll see you next week.